I must admit. I actually never been to Greece, so I'm also accepting any invites.
After the lockdown, of course.
I need to be there on site, hopefully, one day.
Awesome. Summertime, it's better.
And I've seen you're doing some windsurfing, so I need nice spots as well.
Yes, after the cloud architect, I need to do windsurfing, not just surfing on the internet.
Awesome. Okay, so welcome everyone. I'm really happy to see people from around the world. I think the topic of certification is very interesting for a number of reasons. You know, even if you don't know how to start working with GCP, you want to change your career, or you simply want to learn something about GCP in any areas, whether it's purely computing, infrastructure, data engineering, data science, machine learning. The certification, getting prepared for the certification will help you with this. So that's the place for you if you want to do one of those things today. My name is Konrad Clapa. It's probably very difficult to pronounce the second name, and it's quite weird letters in there, so I use only English letters. I work for Atos, which is a managed service company. We actually have a footprint worldwide, and we're almost everywhere in Poland, but we originate from France. We do all kind of IT services and solutions. I basically work on cloud. I specialize in Google Cloud. I'm currently responsible for research and development of our managed offering on Google Cloud Platform. So what I actually do is to create a framework so that we can access to the customer in a streamlined manner, and then manage it for the customer. And we help to enable them with GCP, and then we assist end-to-end, integrating the, including the infrastructure, but also, you know, move of the applications to GCP. You will see that I'm a little bit junky when it comes to certification. So I also wanted to show you something about myself, that I still have my life besides the work. So what I really love doing, that's why I was asking about windsurfing spots. I really love windsurfing. We have some nice spots in Poland. I try to spend the summer somewhere at the seaside of Poland, actually doing windsurfing. So that's my place where I love to spend time when it's summer. There are a couple of things that about myself. I love cooking, trying to master doing some Napoli type pizza, but I'm far away from perfection. So if anyone has any tips, I'm happy to accept them. I love cooking all types of Mediterranean food. I'm probably not the best in the Polish cuisine, but you know, I believe in my family, my mother and all my friends who invite me for lunch. So I love Polish food as well. And I try to do jogging. As you can see, the weather is beautiful in Poland, a lot of rain, but I try to keep myself, you know, moving, because I work probably too much. And as it was already said, I have authored this book, which I will show you later and show you how it can also help you with as one of the source for, you know, preparing for the examination. Okay, so what we're going to look at is first start with the portfolio of the exams. I want to show you what exams are available and how you can start your journey and pick up which exam is good in particular for you. And then we will scope on one of the exams, the Cloud Architect, which is the entry exam, I would call it, that you should start with, and show you how you should prepare for it with a couple of tips. And I hope afterwards I can answer all of your questions that you have put on the chat. Okay, so as you see, the portfolio as the exam is quite massive. So Google, when I started my journey, there were three certificates available, the Cloud Architect, Cloud Engineer, sorry, there was also G Suite exam available as well, and Data Engineer. So this is my suggestion. The first thing you need to understand which path you want to take and what's your daily job, where you want to get experience. So this is my personal view on the exam. This is not like official way how Google sees the path, but this is my experience. So I want to share with you how I see it when I took the exam and how they are connected. So first, think about what's your major, what you want to specialize on. Yes? So if you want just to learn about Google Cloud because you use it for, let's say, for development, and you're starting your journey, right? So you can start with Cloud Architect. The Cloud Architect is the best exam for having an overall understanding of GCP. So it's asking you general questions about how each of the services work. So we have maybe not such a deep understanding of the services, but you are able to at least high level understand which services you would need to use for migrating your applications to GCP. Then you have this Cloud Engineer exam, which you can actually start with as well. But the difference between those two exams is rather that the engineer is more about operation or in GCP. So they're asking you about different ways of how you manage it. Rather than asking you how you design something, it's more of a question how you manage something, how you deploy the services. So it contains a lot of CLI questions. It's containing also questions about how you manage stuff. So all of those exams actually contain information about cloud operations, which was previously called Stackdriver. But yeah, that's basically the difference. And you could choose this path, or maybe you're more into the workspace area. So maybe you're managing the users in your company, you're managing the mailboxes in your company. You're more working on this workspace part than a workplace part than on the cloud engineering part. So that might be a path for you, because this is all about G Suite, including cloud identity, and about managing users, managing Chromebooks, you know, managing mailbox, calendars. So this is all like, if you're coming from the world of Microsoft, that would be, you know, like Active Directory, Microsoft Exchange, and all those tools around. And there is one more exam that unfortunately you can't take, and that's for a reason. You probably have seen the announcement that the G Suite basically has been rebranded to Workspace. So that's why Google has said that this exam expires, and they're currently working on creating a new curriculum for the exam. It's probably going to be called Workspace, not G Suite. That's the information I got. So you still, if you manage to get the certification, it will be valid for next 2 years, but you can't take it anymore. So this is actually something pending. And once you have this basics of, so if you choose the path of the workspace, you can then go to the Cloud Architect if you want. But well, probably if your work is just around managing users, you can stop with the collaboration engineer. Then, you know, depends on your needs, you can start with the data engineer. So data engineer is all around the services related to big data, data pipelines, and partially machine learning as well. So for me, it's like an optional step because not everyone is a data engineer, but it's good to have this one because that's the power of GCP. GCP is very powerful when it comes to managing data, analyzing the data, processing data. So that's all what this exam is about. What we're missing here is actually the machine learning exam, which is pretty new. So I would say that we can put it somewhere. I don't want to give you any guidelines on machine learning because I didn't take it yet. I'm planning to take it soon. And for me, it's extremely difficult exam because I had nothing to do with machine learning. In my past, I was just curious about it, but I never worked with machine learning. So I'm starting from day zero. And from what I understood, you really need to have a very good basic. So you need to know how to use, how to program with TensorFlow, how to create the models, how to process the data before creating the models, how to serve the data. So, well, probably once I take this exam, I can give you some tips, but For me, it seems like it's going to be one of the most difficult exams that's there available. The next step is networking and security path. I put it all together because at the time I was taking those exams, there were quite there were some areas that were covered by both of those exams. So, for example, firewalls, things like Cloud Armor, for example. So those are things related. Very often the services that are network services, they are also security services. So I actually prepared for those two exams at the same time because they were in beta. So I must say the coverage was like 30% of those exams covered each other. And I'm not entirely sure that they are very good. There are some trainings, the courses for those exams, but I think we're still lacking a really good course that's very comprehensive. And for those exams, you need to use Google Docs basically and test it yourself because there's not really, if there is really good source, please put it in the chat if you know one. I would be happy to know about this as well. And then you have two exams which are also connected, I think, DevOps and developer exam. So DevOps is mainly about, you know, how you build your application, how you deploy them. So including things like cloud build, source code repositories, what else? So cloud build, source code repositories, all the things around, you know, DevOps. And also SRE, so you need to understand the concept of site reliability engineering, different metrics that you use in site reliability engineering, like SLO, SLIs. There is a really nice book for this exam, which is developed by Google. So it was released by Google, but it's quite lengthy. So you know, if you want to get into very much details, you should use this book, but basically, I would suggest that you go through the courses that are available, the official courses on SRE in Coursera. So this can give you a brief idea how it works, and it's quite enough for this exam, I must say. And developer, of course, it's all about, you know, developing your application and running them on Compute Engine, on App Engine, and Kubernetes, so GKE. And finally, we have exam that is currently only invitation. So this is Hybrid Multi-Cloud Fellow, actually the full name, official full name, I think it's the Google Cloud Certified Fellow in Hybrid and Multi-Cloud. So I said this is an invitation only, and this is all around running your applications in a hybrid and multi-cloud scenario. So running them on-premise, with GKE on-prem, Anthos on-prem, running the application in GCP, on GKE in GCP, on GKE in AWS, and in future in Azure. So, you know, okay, basically...
The first question from Adrian Halaburda. So after the certification, is it necessary to wait a while to take the next exam?
No. If you fail, you need to wait 14 days. After the second, if you fail the second attempt, you need to wait 60 days. And if you fail your third attempt, I think it's a year that you need to wait. But all those exams, if you want, you can take them in probably 2 weeks if you're prepared. Maybe except the fellow, yes. But those exams, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 exams you could actually take in a row. I'm not sure if you can, I think you can book 2 exams. You can book, I'm not sure what's the limit, but I think I booked 2 exams recently without having to pass, you know, in sequence. Yeah, so I have one booked, I think, for next Friday and another one for Monday the next week.
Okay. Thank you.
Cool, no worries. I'm happy there are questions because it means people didn't leave. Okay, so that's it for like a path that you might take. And let's concentrate now on an example of the exam, like cloud architect, yes? So again, you're expected to have a really high level understanding of, but all of the services. You need to understand how to design it, how to make it secure. So this basically means those are IAM policies. So what IAM roles you need to set for the particular service to be secure. And this is pretty important because it's actually appears in every single exam. So be sure that you understand how you secure your services with the roles. I think every single exam has that. Yes, it's very important. The management, so obviously, is how you, the tools that you use. So you can expect that there might be one or two questions related to CLI, how to monitor it. And this is, again, something that you will need for every single exam. So previously, it was Stackdriver used for monitoring. So Stackdriver logging, Stackdriver monitoring. Probably it has already, the naming has already changed in the exam as well, because Google is pretty good in, you know, changing the names of the exams, sorry, the content of the exam. So probably it's already cloud operations and cloud monitoring, cloud logging. But I'll find out probably in 2 weeks' time. And you need to understand how you optimize your costs, how you're being charged for the services. And obviously, you need some general IT knowledge. That's outside of Google platform. It's really interesting because it's one of the exams that actually, you know, sometimes I feel they come with the questions that are outside of Google area. So, for example, they might ask you in the DevOps, I might see questions about the Jenkins, for example, yes, which is not a Google product, but it happens. And expect that 20% of those questions will be related to case studies. So some of the exams have case studies. I'm not sure now, there are probably two or three case studies. They are already on the Google website, on the examination website. You can see the guide and the case study, so you can read through it. I suggest you just, you know, take a highlighter, print it out, take and try to think about how you would design the solution based on those case scenarios and what services maybe are good for those cases. You know, like a very typical case is around, you know, customer using Hadoop and Spark, and you know, whether you're going to use Dataflow or Dataproc for it. So that's a very common question. Important thing, no prerequisites for the exam. I've been taking a lot of exams in past on different vendors, and you had like to take one exam, you had to have another exam. Yeah. So even for the GCP certified fellow, if you are, you know, have experience in Antalk, but you didn't take any exam before, and you know, Google finds you as a person that they should invite to the exam, they will do that, yes? So you don't really need additional, there are no prerequisites. You don't need Cloud Architect, for example. The fee is $200. So yeah, it's good to get this sponsored by your employer. That's the ideal situation. There are some exceptions from this. It can be 120 if you take the beta, but you need to add the obviously, you need to add the taxes on top of it. So I took the opportunity to take the beta. So currently, you can actually, if you're interested, there is a beta for the developer exam. It's the 2.0 version of this exam, and it's still in beta, and you can take it until the end of next week, I believe. Yeah. So you need to rush because probably, you know, the three slots will be gone. Another important thing, you have 72 hours to reschedule your exam. So, you know, try to get prepared, but there are some, you know, corner cases where you can't do anything and, you know, you need to reschedule. I have rescheduled a couple of times. So remember, 72 hours and then you don't need to pay anything. You can just reschedule for any other date that's available. Another important thing is that there is no pass mark. So this is unfortunate, really. So if you take the exam, in case you fail, or even if you pass, you don't see the results. So You see the result, whether you passed or you failed, but you don't see how many points you got. I'm not sure if this will be fixed. We've been actually talking to Google about this. We've been giving this feedback from GDG as well, but I'm not sure if they're going to ever fix that. So it's a shame, actually, because I would do the exam. I would like to know where I did good and where did I do bad so I can improve. But you can't get that, unfortunately.
We have two questions.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so what's your advice for an IT specialist with networks and operating systems management? What is the most related exam to that field from your point of view? This is the first question.
What was the first part? I didn't.
It's an IT specialist with networks and operating systems management. What is the most related exam to that field from your point of view?
I think it very much depends on where you specialize, yes, because the network is a massive topic. But I would start with the cloud architect exam because it gives you an entry point, right? Don't start with the networking exam for sure, because networking exam is already asking you questions from the cloud architect exam. So I think cloud architect is a must. And then if you work a lot on networking on GCP, so for example, you know, you're responsible for setting up interconnects, you're responsible for designing the network for the customer, and you have this networking experience, which is very valuable, believe me, in the networking, in the cloud today, because most of the people are coming either their application or they are coming from the operating system management. We really lack people that have deep understanding of network and they can design networks for the customer. Because using cloud is not just about putting workloads, you still need to understand how you to connect to the on-prem, how you route traffic, you need to calculate, you know, how much it's going to cost. So this is, I think it's a pretty good career, actually, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. We'll continue to the next question. Where to get best free enablement material and certification vouchers?
That's a great question. I'm not sure there are any free vouchers. But I think that the only chance to get the voucher, smaller price or a discount for a voucher is to take the beta exam. If you want to have a free materials, I think Coursera would be good because you need to watch Coursera on, I don't know, LinkedIn or Twitter, because they very often give 30 days for free. And 30 days, I think, is a lot.
Actually, there is an offer right now from Coursera and Google Cloud. If you register until the 16th of November, you will get 1 month free for Google Cloud courses, specialization courses.
Yes, and Coursera is really good because you also have then access to some quick labs, not to all of them, but some that are related to the courses, you get free access, so you can do hands-on work as well. Hands-on practice.
Okay, last question right now. I'm preparing for professional machine learning engineer certification and advice or prepared learning path like books, courses, or should I complete data engineering certification first, etc., etc., etc.?
I would lie if I say that I can advise you the path. I'm doing it myself as well. What I'm doing, it very much depends on your experience, right? If you're a machine learning expert, I think it will be much easier for you. I'm going through the let me give you some ML exam. I have a couple of materials I can share with you. So actually this was a beta. It's worth thinking.
It was beta last week.
Yes, something I want to really not promote, but I advise you to do. Sign in for Coursera beta tests because then you get access to some of really nice beta tests. So for example, this was for 1 week only, you know it's gone.
Yes, I know.
I made it in this week. I went through it. Really nice course. Hopefully, it will be also available on Plural site. So, yeah, try Coursera. What I'm doing also is to do the crash course, because I'm saying I'm starting completely from zero. Yes, so I'm doing this crash course from Google. Really good stuff. It has the crash course, problem framing, data preparation, clustering, recommendation, debugging. Actually, if you look here, it actually has some labs as well. So if you do it, it has this collab here. So if you go here, you can actually do some hands-on. So you have this collaboration tool where you have a Jupyter notebook and you can, you know, try it yourself. So this is one of the resources. I actually have access to Plural site. This is another really nice resource. So all the courses that you have in Coursera are also available in Plural site. I have access to Plural site because I'm vExpert for VMware. So that's a recognition from VMware for, you know, being active in the community of VMware. And they, for all the VE experts, this Plural site is for free. So I'm using this a lot. And I'm obviously using Google Docs. Google Docs are great. I must say that, you know, without joking, it's really good stuff to use Google Docs because they can describe all the services I like. And, you know, look for people. So they are people who talk about their experience. So search on Google. People can drive you a little bit in the direction what the exam, what you need to focus on. Obviously, everything is in VA, but, you know, which, because sometimes I must say that the preparation guide from Google, there might be a little bit misleading, yes? So it's worth looking around to see what you need to concentrate on. Cool. Any more questions?
You?
Okay, awesome. So this is how to register. So you have this link here. Actually, you can easily find it if you just write in Google register GCP exam. You will see. And actually, this one is pretty tricky to register for the exam. I want to show you something how to get there. If you look at the professional, sorry, that's the book. Register for the exam. This is really funny how you connect to this website, because you go, you find your, you want to register for the exam, you're here, and you see all those exams that you can register for. It's interesting because you have actually, oh, I didn't see that you can actually take the exam in Indonesia. Nice. So if you want to register for the exam, you need to click here, yes? You click here, you're taken to the web accessor, and then you just choose, you need to obviously log in with your user account, or you need to register first. And then it's taking you here and you can register for exam. I'm not sure if I can register for any of them, but you know, for example, here you can for the engineer, and you have on-site and online possibility to book it. Okay, how do the remote test looks like? So this is actually, I haven't been taking this exam yet, but you know, that's what the experience from my colleague with whom I wrote the book. But so you need a webcam and a very stable internet connection, so it shouldn't be flicky. It would be better not to use your mobile phone. The exam is delivered with an app, so you download the app and you know, you register for the you download this app and this is used for to invigilate your laptop, yes, basically. So you need to have this installed first. The images are captured through your webcam, so you need to have your webcam running so that the protector can see you. You also access it via the web accessor portal. So once the time for the exam comes, you log in there and you can just join the exam. You can chat with the protector using a chat. You will need to show your ID via the camera. And, you know, get some time before, make sure that you arrive a little bit earlier so you don't get, you know, angry that something doesn't work and, you know, you cause some additional stress because of it. Official courses that we suggest for to take before taking the Cloud Architect exam. So those are all the courses that we see in Coursera. You probably can find them in Pluralsight. Very useful for starting if you never touched GCP. So this will be recorded. You can just search it in Pluralsight and Coursera later. Official exam guide. So you have this guide where Google, so for every exam you have it. If you search for the exam and you just, let's click it here, you can see that there is curriculum. So, oh, those are the sample cases that I was talking about. So you can see those cases in here. You have sample questions, obviously. That's really good because you can test yourself before taking the exam if you're ready or not. Don't expect that those questions will appear at the exam. It's more of understanding which areas you're weak in and you need to learn more. And here you have the whole curriculum, so you can see what they will be asking you for. And this is, I think for me, for this particular exam, it's not very straightforward. So there are a couple of things that I don't think appears in the exam. I'm not, that's why when we've been writing a book, actually, we took a different approach, looking at what you should prepare from a technical point, because this is very, very generic. But we'll walk through the content of table of content for the book. So I will show you which areas you need to work on. Free tier account. So you can actually create your Google account, but you need to put your credit card in there. There is a free tier that you can use. And until you want to use some services out of the free tier, you will never break it. You will never pay anything. But be aware that the free tier has been changed from the 300 days, I believe, to 90 days recently. So, you know, keep that in mind. And the practice exam that I was talking to you about, it's like 20 questions. So when you feel you're prepared for the exam, take it. You can also take it at the beginning. So you take it at the beginning, you understand where you need to, what you need to learn and what you need to concentrate on. And this study guide is actually the book that we've been talking about, that we developed with Brian Gerard, a colleague of mine, very good colleague of mine. I just wanted to show you this book quickly in terms of the table of content. So we made it in a slightly different way than the exam guide. So we started it from the standpoint of a person never used the person that never used GCP or doesn't even know what cloud is. So that's why we are making some introduction. We're showing you how you book the exam, how to start with GCP, you know, what are the resources, what are the organizations, how you manage it with the resource manager. Then we talk about core services. So we divided the services in GCP into, well, it's according to Google, actually. So into compute, storage, network, big data, machine learning, identity services. And then we actually are looking at each of those services one by one. So this is more, probably more from the engineering point of view, how, you know, the view of an engineer, how I would learn myself those services, because I had problems myself when I looked at the guide, the professional guide. So actually you could look at this if you're not interested in using books, because it's not the source that you want to use. You can still look at this table of content, see, you know, what we've been talking about, and we covered all the topics that you can expect in the exam. Yeah? So managing architecture, so we start with the compute engine, then we talk about the Kubernetes engine. We talk about App Engine, so you have all the three compute options covered, and then we talk about serverless functions. We talk then about networking. I don't think that you need very deep network knowledge for this exam, but you know the basics are important in terms of how you set up your VPCs, what types of VPCs you have, load balancing, NAT, the hybrid connectivity to the local data center, about DNS, firewall, and how you set up private access to your services in GCP. Then we have two chapters about the storage, which is always covered in any exam. The cloud storage is very essential when it comes to the exam. We talk about data store and Firestore, Cloud SQL, again about other services like database services like Spanner, Bigtable. Then we talk about big data, which is including PubSub, Dataflow, BigQuery, Dataproc, Cloud IoT Core. This is like most of the services that you would use for big data. We talk about machine learning, so we make a very small introduction. Obviously, they're not expecting you to have machine learning knowledge as a developer of machine learning models. You don't need to know how to develop them, but you need to know what services are there and how you can use it for machine learning. So the services that you would use to develop your own model, but also how would you use pre-trained model, how would you serve your model to the customers. we also talk about quickly about Dialogflow, AutoML, so other services related to machine learning. We talk about the security, the management options, so how you would manage your GCP using API, Cloud Shell, SDK, use Cloud Deployment Manager, so this infrastructure as a code tool, how to use pricing calculator, and any other considerations related to managing your GCP environment. Then we talk about monitoring, a very good chapter for every single exam. And then we help you with some exam focus. So we are actually analyzing those cases that are described in the guide. So, you can use this table of content, and I really encourage you to come to our GDG meetups, because we're going to give away this book. So hopefully, you can get a copy of it in that meetups. Okay. Quick Labs, again, very useful tools. I'm not sure if you guys have used it ever. So those are basically hands-on labs. So you choose a lab, then Quick Labs is actually using the API to provision the whole infrastructure for you. It gives you the name of the project. It gives you the login to GCP, and you have your private environment for 1 or 2 hours to go through the scenarios. It's quite amazing thing that it works also for other clouds. I think it's available for AWS. Now Quick Labs is part of Google, I believe. They bought Quick Labs. And this is one of the best resources. If you don't have experience with GCP and you don't want to pay a massive bill, try Quick Labs first. You will understand how to use it, and you never will have to pay anything except the credits. I'm not sure if there. I think there are some opportunities as well to get free credits for Quick Labs.
Quick Labs promote almost every day on their social media. A code voucher for 5 credits, and also the GDG, especially the cloud, GDG cloud, have the cloud study jam, so people can attend a cloud study jam and get $55 as credits.
Awesome. It's worth watching announcements. if you Google it, there are always something that you can use for free. But I personally think, if you can afford that, that's one of the best resources to take. If you even need to pay for it, it's better to use this than pay a massive bill on GCP if you never use it. Yeah. So those are the Quick Labs that I'm showing here that we suggest you to take a look at. We also suggest this data engineering because they are some of the services, some of those services in data engineering appear in the exam, as you have seen in the table of contents. So not a deep in-depth knowledge like you would need for the data engineer exam, but still there are questions about how to use those services and when to use them. It's nothing really technical. This is coming from our experience, what we do to pass the exams, right? We are all human. We all have problems with procrastination, you know, for having some excuses not to take the exam. What I really do and like to do is to register for the exam as quick as possible. I make a decision, I'm going to do ML exam, I do it now. Yes, book it. If you get a voucher or, you know, if your employer can sponsor it, it's even easier decision. But you need to make a decision and book it. If you move the date, fine, that's okay. But do it now and book it because you know the whole mindset changes and you start thinking about the deadline to learn to get this exam. Otherwise, you can wait for months and years to take certification. Book the exam at the time that you're most alerted. So I'm, for example, most alerted at like 6 o'clock in the morning. So I'm not sure if it's possible to do that now because there are different weird times as we've been talking, like 12 a.m.
It is possible 24 hours a day. If you find a slot on the day that you want, you can register and take the exam.
Exactly. So it really very much depends on where you're most alerted. So use it. Yeah, don't take the exam at 6 after your work. If you can do it, just talk to your boss and say, okay, I'm taking this exam. It's going to benefit you. So, you know, maybe give me a day off because of it. Yeah? This might be a good way to get away with one day off. Get all materials in place. So when you make a decision that you want to take the exam, just find all the sources that you're going to use. I tend to print out things that I think are very critical, right? And I think that I might have problems remembering. So I print them out, I put them on my table, and I just, you know, pick them up whenever I have a couple of minutes to go through it. Because if you don't have those materials and every time you need to look for it somewhere, it's taking you more and more time. If you have, you know, bookmarked everything that you're going to read, it's much easier because anytime you can reach it, and you have no excuse not to do it. Yeah, so think about that. Obviously, get support from your family, from your boss, from your colleagues, because it's going to take time. So I think my first exam, it took me about 2 months to prepare. And, you know, there is a lot of material. So once you do the Cloud Architect, it's easier to move further. But Cloud Architect, it's quite a milestone that you need to make to move further. And plan your studies, yeah? So without having a specific plan, how many hours you're going to spend every day on learning, I think I would fail. I need to have a straight plan. Okay, this week I'm going to spend that many hours, and at those hours I book it just for purely for studying. Especially if you have to do quick labs, you know, you need to book like an hour or two to do the quick labs because otherwise, you know, you will lose your credits on quick labs and you will not make it. And aim for passing the first attempt. Yes, don't try to take the exam and, you know, try to be lucky. Maybe I'll pass it or not. Get confident. Yes, do the test exam and make sure that you know why you answer things. It's not that you remember that this was the right answer. Just think about, you know, if this question contains information about cloud storage, for example, think how much you know about cloud storage. Do you know everything about the life cycle, about the policies, about the tiers? Think about it in this way. Think about what else you don't know and just clear it. Okay, cool. So that was actually how much time did we spend? 50 minutes.
Don't worry. So just before going to some questions, can you please show again the slide where you have the main required courses on Coursera? Oh, This one, yes, okay, because people need to take a screenshot. And Difa is asking, do you know if there is a scholarship to take the exam?
That's a good question. That's a really good question. We would need to ask that Google. So this is the scholar, you mean for like for students or for regular? Is it about students? Maybe for students, yes.
For students.
Interesting question. I'll try to ask about this. If I think there are really nice programs for students, but for study jams, I believe. But I'm not sure if it's for. I'll ask this question. I have. If you leave your email somewhere or just contact me, if you can contact me on LinkedIn, give me your contact. I will ask about this.
Okay, Difa. Probably. Okay. I see. You are followed on LinkedIn by Difa, so it's great.
Cool.
Another finish. Question? Do you have any other question for Konrad? Nope, no question. Okay, that's great. So Konrad has a question for you. The first person who will answer correct and fast. Okay, sorry. Mute is asking, is Cloud Computing Basics 101 good course on Coursera?
Yeah, but remember that one-on-one, it's always very basic, yes? So if you look at training, it's I don't think it's enough for the certification. So you need to look at all the aspects. It's probably not covering enough, yeah? It's good for starts only. I would rather say that you need to go through all the courses that that we were saying you should be using, because it's the cloud architect is wide. Yeah, it has a lot of services in there. So I think you need more, to be honest.
True, I agree, totally agree. So Konrad has a question for you. If you are correct and the fastest one, you will earn a 1 year free voucher from JetBrain to choose your editor. And the question is?
Okay, so the question will be around Lord of the Rings, because that's probably one of the movies I liked a lot and watched a lot. And the question about Moria. And about the name of the demon that lived in Moria. So what is okay. The name of the demon that lived in Moria? Oh, that
was... Oh, very fast. Nikos Litridis. Okay, we have a winner. Okay, Nico, you have to send me your email on LinkedIn, as a message, and Vasily, goddammit... So send me your email and I will send you the voucher.
Awesome. And again, guys, if you know, if you have any questions, just reach. Answer the question on LinkedIn if, you know, only time permits. So.
Great.
Give me a shout.
Thank you, Konrad, for accepting the invitation. Now it's useless, my contract with you, but I will keep it as a souvenir.
No, it came into fruition.
Maybe I will write over here something about your new book, that you owe me your new book for Arthos. I will cheat. So, people, thank you for attending this virtual tech talk with Konrad. It was a pleasure to have you also here and... read all your questions and ask them to Konrad. Have a nice day, nice evening, nice night. I don't know, because we are all around the world. And thank you for everything.
Okay, thank you, guys. Bye. Cheers.